one summer day on a Digby boat, I fell into conversation with two American tourists. They had been advised, they said, to drive down the valley, and they had done so. They seemed very doubtful to whether they'd done well to take the advice. Apparently, they had not found the experience to be very enjoyable or inspiring. I felt so sorry. They had missed so much. They, too, had left Wolfville in the morning, but they did not see Whittle Hollow, where the little stream making its way down from the hill had been dammed and their escape did not December day. They did not see the sign of Greenwich 1761, and the road across the Dyke Lands to the Cornwall's River Bridge, the lovely little village of Port Williams, where the White Church Spire catches the morning sun. They would not have known that the road would have taken them on to Stars Point and Town Cloth with all their historical associations, the Church Street and Hilton Street, to Jawbone Corner, Canning, and beyond the Blomidon. They did not see the dikes following the curves of the river, the red mud banks on the riverside, and the flowers spangled grass on the meadowside. They had no conception of the importance of these winding walls and of the disorganization of the countryside when there's a break in the dike and the tide comes through. They did not know the connected names still borne by the residents, descendants of the planters in 1760, and they would not have seen the inconspicuous road on the left passing the Greenwich School, going up the hill, giving gorgeous views of the Cornwall's River and all its windings and its dikes, of the Gaspereau and the Black River and the dams thrown across each. And chances are they did not see the deep hollow island, nor take this torturous course of the hills so thrilling to nod to the little community of White Rock, where the steep descent down the bridge across the Gaspereau and in the steeper climb mirrored the communities of South Bank. The Blomidon Roads, Esther Clark Wright, 1957, the first two pages of chapter 2. Rest assured, Esther continues on her road trip all the way down to Digby, painting vivid imagery the entire way. A perfect time capsule. A snapshot of what life was like in this magnificent valley 63 years ago. Now, of course, the road would have taken her directly through Kentville, where there she suggests that the unseen tourists probably did not even admire the stately elms of Kentville's main streets or dignified homes, not so much as even guess at the strong suburbs going up the hill and out of sight. They would not have known that Kentville had made history by electing a woman mayor and finding that her charm was backed by administrative ability, electing her again and again. Today, we in part remember Mayor Gladys Porter by her bridge across the river going into Port Williams, one of a number of examples of Kentville's contribution to the evolution of transportation here in this Annapolis Valley. After all, there's been centuries of trips down to Digby not involving an automobile whatsoever. Today, in downtown Kentville, at the former site of the King's Municipal Building, still the Justice Building, still a different structure, a four-story white building, an important building, well, building that Archie's going to tell us more about. Archie, are you here?
I'm right here! And it was right here! This tall, four-story factory building, the very center of commerce. This was the beating heart of the Industrial Revolution. It was right here! Built in 1868. Can you see it? It was the home of the Nova Scotia Carriage Corporation, the original NSCC. They launched in 1868, and they were renowned builders of 12 distinct sleigh types, over 22 distinct types of horse-drawn carriages. Progress is impossible without change, and with the dawning of the automobile revolution came the sunset of the horse-drawn carriage age, and that presented an opportunity. My friends, John and Dan MacKay, they had the means, and with the recently vacated factory, they had the opportunity, and they meant to make cars. What they lacked was the know-how. And that's where I come in. My name is Archie Pelton, ladies and gentlemen. And when I was a teenager, I set off down, as so many young folks do, to seek my fortune. I worked up and down the American seaboard, and in 1902, I found myself in New York City for the world's first international car show. It was a thing to behold. I was so overwhelmed, I bought two cars then and there, had them boxed up and shipped back here to the Annapolis Valley. I was coming home in style. Now, you know that when the first of those cars arrived, I had it unboxed and I took it out on the open road. Now, the motion pictures may paint the driving of an automobile of a 1902 vintage as a very simple thing to do. I fear I maybe got 100 yards before I smacked into the side of the barn and I knocked that car all to pieces. Still, clouds and silver lining and all, because I vowed then and there I would put that car back together. Bolt on bolt if I had to. By gum, I did it. It took a while. It was quite a bit of fussing and a feuding, but I put that car back together. And in the process, I learned a thing or two about how cars are assembled and how to make a car go. Secret is the booty. Now, that car, both those cars, both the refurbished one and the brand new one, I ended up selling to buyers in Halifax, making me the first used and new car salesman in all of Nova Scotia. Perhaps the entirety of the Eastern Seaboard, but far be it from me to think of a horn. Now, it was in 1910 that Jack and Dan really got serious. That was when they sent me down into the New England states, where I purchased the parts to put 25 cars together at once. Can you imagine 25 cars on an assembly line? No wonder we needed that four-story ginormous space. We employed people from all around the area to put that car together. We had cabinet makers to build the body. We had blacksmiths to weld the frame together. Wow. I even found work for my otherwise fairly useless brother, let me tell you. Whew. I mean, don't get me wrong. It's not like the automobile was an overnight success by any stretch of the imagination. Why, as recently as 1908, it was illegal to drive your car on Sundays. Can you imagine? Now, of course, that's because the first cars were nowhere near the quality of the McKay motor car. I mean, the McKay motor car. Whew, one car, but... Do you remember the Stanley Steamer? Oh boy. Stanley Steamer. See, it ran on kerosene, and then the kerosene got the water going, and that ran the turbine. Virtually silent, clean burning, beautiful car. Only had one major setback. You see, note that I said virtually silent. See, the Stanley Steamer was inaudible to our own ears, but extremely loud to our four-legged canine companions. You would know a Stanley Steamer was coming down the road because the car, that dogs were just such a howling blocks away. And probably the highlight of my career so far, I think it was last year, John McKay and I, we took one of our production top-of-the-line McKay motor cars and we drove it clear across the country, all the way to Saskatchewan, to Regina, Saskatchewan, 2,300 miles on the open road. We were the first to ever accomplish that. Not the last, I suspect. Now, you might think that 2,300 miles may seem quite daunting, but let me tell you, when you're behind the wheel of a production McKay automobile, 35, maybe even sometimes 40 miles per hour, woo, those roads just fly past. It's a delight. And whenever we got homesick for that Nova Scotian air, it was simple. We just get down there next to the tire and take a little suck of that blue nose air. Cures what ails you. I mean, things are going great. Last year, you remember? The Chronicle Herald, they had that contest moving to every make of motor car imaginable. All the way from Halifax, through the valley here, down to Yarmouth, and back down the South Shore. Anybody care to venture a guess as to which car took top prize? Oh, you know it! You know it, it was a McKay! Woo! Beautiful cars. Still, there are clouds on the horizon, I fear, and progress, as I say, is impossible without change. There are rumors. There is a group of investors that plans to move our production to Amherst. I mean, it makes sense. They have the foundries we like, they have more population still. I hate to see Kentville lose the work. Our valley here is a beautiful home, and we should protect it. As for me, with McKay motor cars on the way out, I've been thinking about maybe even running for mayor. What do you think? Will you vote for me, Jerome?
I vote for you.
Nice, brother. See, as for me, I'm afraid I have to bid you adieu. I thank you so much for your time. I will thank you much more for your votes.
Yes, the company did move to Amherst, was only in production for another year, or
run out of the Raven Capitol and have to shut its doors. Archie, our friend, did run for mayor, and he was elected. You want to know more about Valley Ghost Walks? Our lucky 13th season is starting up Apple Blossom Thursday, continuing every Thursday till Halloween. If you're looking for a few good men to still get involved, let me know. Good evening.